So yeah, we're talking about post-quantum cryptography, and this is an area that you know, I've done a bit of research in, and recently we filmed a video essay for the Internet Seriously called Quantum Computing for Babies, and here is the book that we used on quantum computing for babies. And you know, it starts off talking about bits, and then we get to, you know, quantum bits and how computers solve problems. So Kirsty, what do you think about quantum computing for babies?
You know, I think it's a misnomer because it covers quite some topics in detail that a few adults could learn from as well. You know, I think even if you're comfortable with the idea of bits, and few people are, but qubits is a whole nother level, the quantum bits. And I think it describes it in a very nice visual way. So anyone who's vaguely interested in the topic, I think it's a good book to start off.
Have you read Quantum Computing for Babies? Do you own the
book? I have read it. I think there's a whole series recommended to some of my friends who are parents. You can have Pythagorean Theorem for Babies. There's a whole range of maths, physics books for babies.
Baby,
I think, because you can get an over-focus on animal noises, and it's good to introduce them to qubits and parallel processing when they're very young.
Can I just ask about this, Kirsty? Because as an engineer, I don't have enough time to work in quantum and really study it, but I just read what I can. So In this discussion, I am the baby, and I thought quantum for babies was just really talking about just a nice polite way of saying quantum for dummies, but not being, you know, derogatory, not being insulting to people. But you know, I got my head round qubits and what quantum for babies is telling you. But qubits is like a spinning coin. It's heads and tails in a supposition, and then you commit an act of measurement, so you actually try and pin down a value, and then it causes a qubit to collapse. I didn't see or read any of this in Quantum for Babies, like I would expect in Quantum for Dummies, or how that leads to quantum parallelism. I can't even say that word, which is the whole art is multiple calculations at the same time, which I'm really fascinated by, but I'm just completely stumped. I'm sorry, Quantum for Babies did not help me get there.
I think if you're already quite advanced and you know about things like superposition and measurement collapsing the state of a quantum bit, maybe you don't need to start with Quantum for Babies. Maybe it's more like Quantum for Teenagers, or
a bit further
along, you know. But exactly what you're saying, this is kind of introducing the idea. For a lot of people, they can't hold the idea that bits can exist in neither zero nor one, yet both at the same time. You know, the whole idea is crazy.
It's sort of magical in a way as well, isn't it? I find
like
it really,
technology, it's just magic.
Yeah, but also, can you explain a little bit about entanglement and how that actually works in practice? I've seen lots of people, you know, pictures of people wearing these kind of scanning things on their head for brain scans, and the idea that two particles can know each other and be connected so that they always know where each other are, so that you can look inside people's heads or deeply underground or around corners. Is that really true?
Yeah.
Good, thank you very much.
Maybe we could talk, because I think perhaps even if your listeners have read Quantum for Babies, they won't know about superposition and collapsing of measurement.
Can you do the definitions bit? Yes.
Yeah, quick 101. So superposition is where the qubits are both in zero and one. They don't have a fixed state. And then, as you said, Lucien, when you measure them, or when you observe, when you look, they collapse to one of those states. Then their state becomes fixed, so zero or one.
So that would be a bit like if a qubit is a spinning coin, it's actually, the moment you slap it on your hand, it's committed to being either heads or tails.
We have a little animation.
Schrödinger's cat, which is kind of famous, you know, that the cat is both alive and dead until you look in the box, and then it collapses to one of those states. So that's why everyone talks about Schrödinger's cat.
Yeah, I never really understood the cat's bit.
Well, we've got an animation of a qubit, which is for our video essay on quantum computing for babies. So this is made by our animator. And so, I asked for this to be made. And Kirsty, do you think this is a good representation of a qubit? Is there anything you'd change, you know, some feedback?
It's not bad, is it? I suppose it's quite tough to represent such an abstract concept for many people. I think that theta angle dancing around the middle might scare a few folks off. It's exactly this idea, right, that it's living somewhere in this sphere. And this is a three-dimensional representation. Of course, it can be much higher than that. So it's just sort of this randomness that picture is depicting, I suppose. And so then going back to Emily's point, entanglement is how you can have two qubits that can be really some distance apart. And they are, when you measure one, it collapses to that state and the other one will do the same thing. So this is how a lot of people envisage key sharing in the future, that you have a quantum kind of key on one end of a wire, and as soon as anybody looks at it, it will collapse to this state, and that same key exists at the other end of that entangled wire.
I'm quite keen to sort of steer the conversation. So in my video essay, Quantum Computing for Babies, I argue that everyone gets quite tied up in all these specifics, all the quantum mechanical concepts like entanglement and like qubits, and actually it's kind of important to not get too lost in the technical details when there are big issues like post-quantum cryptography. What are your views on that, Kirsty?
Yeah, exactly. So I think that when we talk about this, it's really important to focus on the outcomes. And quantum computers sound very cool. You know, the number of qubits is increasing, but what does it really mean? And the biggest application for cryptographers is that it will break all of our cryptography that is currently used on the internet today if we have a large enough quantum computer. Now, we're nowhere near that at the moment, but it could happen. It may never happen, also, just to say, but it could happen in the future. No one really knows when. Maybe most estimates say about 10 to 15 years away, but that has been the estimate for the last sort of 30 years, and we still don't have a quantum computer. So that's one major application of quantum computing for cryptographers. But in all sorts of applications, you know, in medicine, as with any kind of advance in computing, there are lots of applications to a wide range of sectors. But the one that I'm really interested in is the encryption side.
Yeah. Kirsty, can I just pick up on the encryption side? Because we both have had some experience or looking at the digital standards arena, and there is a lot of activity in those arenas around trying to standardise the next stage of encryption, the way that we protect our secrets online. Could you just give a little bit of an introduction of, you know, imagining that 10 or 15 year horizon does actually happen, we have quantum computing in our lives, what will it do to strong encryption, the way that we protect our secrets, our security, our bank accounts, and what needs to happen and who needs to take action now to protect those secrets?
Yeah, it's such a range of things, because cryptography covers, you know, key exchanges, it covers signatures, which is a way of authenticating and saying I am who I say I am and verifying. It covers, you know, block ciphers like AES, which just encrypts lots of material at once, and it covers as well. And all of these are differently vulnerable to quantum computing. So it's not just everything needs replacing immediately. There's a phase and a stage to go through. And the main thing that's affected is the way we protect information and the way that we prove we are who we say we are. So for most people, this probably looks like software updates on your phone, actually. That update comes from a trusted source. You know it's come from Google or Samsung or whoever, and you can download that update. And that method of proving that it is really Google pushing out this update to you, that's vulnerable to quantum computing. And so is the encryption, the way we keep our information secret online. And so for banks, it's a good example, because you probably have a mortgage that lasts many years. If you only have a mortgage that lasts 1 year, good for you. But most people's financial information, bank accounts and loans and stuff, it's sensitive for a long time, for their lifetime. And so because that's such a long period of time, even though 10 to 15 years sounds like a long way away, it's not when you consider it in that context. So large organizations need to plan. They need to plan to be able to migrate. Right now, we don't have quantum cryptography algorithms embedded in protocols. We do have the algorithms themselves standardized, but we don't have a new internet standard for how to use these quantum algorithms. But organizations still need to plan. So today they need to look at the assets they have. They need to think about what needs to migrate, what's a priority, how long it will take to migrate those assets. You know, if it takes 10 years to migrate your assets, you're already too slow if you've not started. So you really have to make sure your timeline fits. So the average individual, you should probably do nothing. Your organizations and banks, they should be taking care of this for you. But if you're a bit of a nerd, it's just quite interesting to know that this is coming.
So